Chattamish. Show enough. Oh Lord, I thank you, Father. Oh God, I thank you, Father. I thank you for this day, Lord. Hallelujah. I yield myself to you today, God. Hallelujah. I increase while your spirit increase. But Father, I know that you have given me power and authority to speak the word. And I know that you're by my side. And I know I'm not up here by myself, but your spirit stands within me. And so I thank you, Father, for what you're about to do. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I give honor to Pastor Blake. Hallelujah. My pastor, and to my first lady, Elder Kalina Blake. And to all the saints of God. Hallelujah. Could you turn with me to St. John 3:16, a scripture that we all probably know by heart, and a scripture that we've heard and quoted many times, a very familiar scripture, John 3:16. Hallelujah. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life."
Talk about it.
Hallelujah. For God so loved the world, that means God loves everyone. He loved the thief, the murderer, the prostitute. He loved you and me. He loved the sinner, but he hates the sin.
Yeah.
All right.
Romans 5:8 says that God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, hallelujah,
hey,
Christ died on the cross for us.
Come on, man.
So what kind of manner of love is this that a man will lay down his life?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Who do you know is willing to give and sacrifice their only son? Their son unto death. Their only child or any child. Most of us have a hard time sacrificing our time, let alone a child. And God is calling for us to sacrifice our time with him. Hallelujah. He wants us to draw near to him and he'll draw near to us. Hallelujah. We thank God. Our time is not mentioned. Most of us have a hard time giving God our time, not to mention a child. God is calling for people who have a willingly answer, that will willingly answer his call. God called Abraham, and Abraham said, "Behold, here I am." How many of us are God is calling and we're saying, "Here I am"? God is waiting for us to answer him. Hallelujah. Abraham said, "Behold, here I am." Even though Jesus prayed to God to take away this cup from me, Jesus said, "Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." Even Jesus answered the call. Hallelujah. God is calling each one of us for ministry.
Come on.
I don't care if everybody may not be a minister.
Come on.
Everybody may not be a preacher. But everybody is called to ministry.
Yeah.
You should be ministering to somebody.
Amen.
In your family. You can start off with the people in your family.
That's
the
right.
People in your neighborhood.
Come on.
Somebody ought to know, hallelujah, the love of God in you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. What is your answer when God calls you?
Come on.
Do you say, "Behold, here I am, Lord"?
Uh-huh.
Hallelujah. Use me the way that you want to.
Come on.
Are you willing to sacrifice? What are you willing to sacrifice? What are you willing to give up? Hallelujah. Will you give up Facebook for an hour? Hallelujah. Will you give up texting? Hallelujah. And we're not going to talk about drinking. Hallelujah. Will you give it up for God? God is waiting on you. He's calling for you. Hallelujah. When God called Abraham to Mount Moriah and offered his son Isaac as a sacrifice, Abraham was obedient to God and was prepared to do just that. But at the last possible moment, after Abraham had tied Isaac to the altar and was prepared to plunge the knife into his heart, God stopped him, saying, "Do not lay your hands on the lad, for I know that you fear God, since you did not withhold your only son from me. God later provided Abraham with a ram in a bush.
Yes.
Just like he provided Jesus as our ram in our bush.
Yeah.
And one thing about Abraham, God was able to keep him from making way for him not to kill his son, but God sent his son to die for us.
Yeah.
That Jesus made the ultimate death. He did the ultimate death by dying for us. He died in place for us. When we should be dead, we're still living because of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And the sacrifice that he made upon the cross.
Right. Yes. Right.
Hallelujah. We thank you that Isaac didn't have to, because the lamb died in his place.
Mm.
And just like we don't have to die because Jesus died in our place.
Come on.
What will you sacrifice today?
All right.
What will you give up for Jesus
yeah.
today? I thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
For blessing me. I thank you, Lord, for giving us a choice. You give us a will. But you will want your will to be done in our lives.
Yeah.
And so, Father, we thank you, hallelujah, for sacrifice today.
Yeah.
What will you sacrifice?
Yeah.
Hallelujah, in your life for Jesus.
Amen, amen. Sister Deborah, can you stand up for 1 second, please? I just want to say, the Holy Spirit knew what he was doing, because we had the same scripture. The exact same scripture, so apparently somebody need to hear it today, amen?
Amen.
Okay.
Come on,
pray,
boy. Come on.
I was just going to see, like, wow. All right. John 3:16-17. No, not at all. John 3:16-17 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." 17 says, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." I want to talk about three things today: love, healing, and hope. Love, healing, and hope. And if I must title this, everybody know I listen to gospel songs more than any other song. So I went with Erica Campbell. I love God, you don't love God, what's wrong with you? All right? I love God, you don't love God, what is wrong with you? In this day and age that we are living in, we need Jesus like never before. People are getting killed in the city of Chicago, over 600 people year to date. The presidential race is a joke. It is, and we have crazy people in Israel, child molesters, man-raping women, police brutality, and drugs. If we ever needed Jesus, we need him for sure, which is today. The scripture says that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. But yet, this is the world that we live in.
Yeah.
It also says that he sent not his son to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. The world meaning us, that we may be saved through him. Not so we can die, but so we can have everlasting life. If that ain't love, I don't know what is. Amen?
Amen.
Next, we're going to go with healing. We know that God is a healer. We know in Mark chapter 5:21-34, there was a woman with the issue of blood.
All right.
And how she spent all what she had to see doctors to get better, but instead the Bible says that she got worse. The woman did believe that if she had faith and touched Jesus' clothes, she will be healed. Verse 29 declares that immediately the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her affliction. Immediately means instant. So that means, that's what caught my attention, because immediately she had faith enough to believe that immediately she would be healed if she touched him.
Come on.
Ah.
How many know that God is a healing man? He won't take long to heal you.
Yeah.
The issues that we face dealing with the health of people or cares of the world, as long as you are in Jesus' face, he will immediately heal you.
Ah.
Verse 34 says, he told her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your affliction." Verse 28, she decreed and declared that she will be healed. She said it herself. Verse 28 says, "For she said, if I only may touch his clothes, I shall," which means I will, "be made well."
Mm.
The same can happen for you if you keep your mind and focus stayed on him. And she had that great faith.
Come
that
on.
Was that great faith because she confessed it. She decreed and declared it.
Come
Amen.
On.
Lastly, God knows that we are going to do what we're going to do, when we do it, and he has planned out our lives for us. This is the hope. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope."
Yeah.
I love God. You don't love God?
I love
God. What is wrong with you?
I love
God. He wants to give us peace and not to be evil to one another. He wants us to have a future and be of hope. He wants nothing. He wants to give us the peace and to be nice to one another. And he wants nothing but good things for us. And some of us can't even realize it because we're not praying, we're not in our word, and we're not focused on him. If we love God, why can't we be like him? The Bible says he created us after his own image. Psalm 23:2-5 says, "He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." Verse 6 says, "You prepare a table in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over." If that ain't love, I don't know what is, because he's leading me beside the still waters. He wants me to have peace. This man is restoring my soul. He's walking with me when I'm going through it. Even though it seems dirt in the tunnel, I'm coming out of it. He didn't say I stayed there, I'm walking through. Then he says, "I prepared a table in front of you in the presence of my enemies." You tell me these people, the same people that talk about me, gonna prepare a table in front of them? It says, "Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all." Psalms 34:19. You telling me after all I've been through, all of my hurt and the pain I've been through, you still go deliver me?
Come on.
I love God. You don't love God? What is wrong with you?
Come on.
It says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk after the flesh, but after the Spirit." Romans 8:1. You telling me all I gotta do is walk after the Spirit?
Yeah.
And I won't be condemned? I love God. You don't love God? What's wrong with you?
Alright.
But he was pierced for our transgressions, and he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed. You telling me he suffered a beating for me?
Come on.
He did all that so I can live and so I can be healed? I love God. You don't love God? What is wrong with you first? Then it says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways are my ways, says the Lord. For as heaven is higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." Are you telling me your thoughts is better, and you got bigger and better things for me? I just sat here and thought about something else, but you telling me you're taking me higher? I love God. You don't love God? What is wrong with you? It goes on to say, "And my God shall supply all of our need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus." Philippians 1:19. You telling me I'm broke, but you still go supply for me? I'm over here worrying, and you still go do what you said you was gonna do?
Yeah.
I love God.
Yeah.
You love God? What is wrong with you? Mm. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in a time of trouble. Psalm 46:1. You telling me after all I've been through, all this trouble I've been in, you gonna be my strength?
Yeah.
That is love right there. If that ain't love, I don't know what it is, Pastor.
My God.